إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ونبيه ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. All praise and glory be to Allah. We thank Him and we seek His help and His guidance and His pleasure and His forgiveness and His protection from the evil whispers within us and from the awful consequences of our misdeeds. For whomever Allah guides, no one can lead astray, and whomever Allah leaves without guidance, none can guide them. And we testify that none is worthy of our worship and our devotion and our absolute love and obedience but Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth and everything in them, and everything between them, and everything we know and everything we don't. And we bear witness that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in truth his prophet and his servant and his messenger and the best of his creation and the seal of his revelation and the most beloved of the slaves of Allah to Allah. O people of Iman, O you have believed, Allah says, O you have believed, keep mindful of Allah, remain conscious of Him, keep your duty to Him in the manner to the extent that He deserves. Give Him His due regard in every aspect of your life as best as you can, and do not die except in a state of complete and total willing, loving surrender to Allah, meaning a state of Islam. To begin, after welcoming our brothers and sisters to the house of Allah Azza wa Jal, we spent last Friday during the khutbah speaking about the incredible personality of Ibrahim alayhi salam, of Abraham, peace be upon him, the Khalil of Allah, the friend of God, who served God in every dimension of his life. As some of the scholars put it, كَانَ قَلْبُهُ لِلرَّحْمَانِ, his heart belonged to Ar-Rahman. وَوَلَدُهُ لِلْقُرْبَانِ, and his son was used for Qurban, as a means of coming near to Ar-Rahman, a means of devotion. He was willing to give up his son. He said, وَمَالُهُ لِلْضِيفَانِ, and his wealth was for the guests. That was dedicated. He was the greatest host ever to any guests. He was the exemplar of how to host your guests. And we spent the week speaking of the khutbah, last week speaking about that. They said, وَبَدَنُهُ لِلْنِيرَانِ, and his body itself was expendable. He didn't mind getting thrown into the niran, getting thrown into the fire, and not turning away from his religion, not turning away from worshipping the one true God without idols, without partners, without intermediaries, the way his people had done. And so his heart belonged to Allah. His wealth was serving the guests for the sake of God, to please God. His son was for a means of getting closer to God, even if that meant slaughtering him, right? And even his body was for the sake of Allah, even if it meant it would be burned in a fire at the hands of those persecutors. And now we wish to speak about this aspect of worship, of hosting the guest, but from the opposite side, being hosted as a guest. So you being the host is an act of worship in Islam. But likewise, you being the visitor, you being the guest is also an act of worship in Islam. Meaning, this is something that Allah loves for you to do, and you part of you being a Muslim, surrendering to Allah's lifestyle, His way of life, is that He wants people to exchange visits. He wants people to visit one another because of the benefit in that for them, for their own good. God loves to see people strengthening their social bonds, breathing love one with another. And so Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, for example, in Sunan al-Nasa'i, he says, كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَزُورُ الْأَنصَارَ فِي بُيُوتِهِمْ. The Prophet ﷺ used to visit the Ansar. You know, the Muslims, when they were persecuted, they fled Mecca and came to Medina. Those who fled Mecca were called the Muhajirin, the migrants. And those who took them in graciously were the Ansar, the supporters in Medina. And so these Ansar The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was one of the migrants. He wouldn't just stay in his own corner in Medina. And yes, we were friends, we're all Muslims, that's fine, but I'm with them, I'm not with you. So he would go out of his way to visit them in their homes. Not in the Muhajirin homes. Would visit the Ansar, he says, fi buyutihim. Anas, the narrator, says, and he would go up to their children, وَيَمْسَحْ عَلَى رُؤُوسِ أَوْلَادِهِمْ, and wipe their heads, he would pet the heads of the children, وَيَدْعُوا لَهُمْ, and he would make dua for them as well. And so think of how busy the Prophet ﷺ was. He saw that visiting people in their homes was indispensable. This is a part of the lifestyle that must exist among the Muslims, because this is what builds the social fabric. He, alayhi salatu wasalam, was busier than we are today in the busy life. And so the reality is, it's not, we're not so much busier than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Yes, we are busier than ages past, it's true. But certain aspects of our busyness can be trimmed, like there's fat to be trimmed from our lifestyle. There is also lots of movie watching and lots of time wasted and lots of social media being draining 4 or 5 hours of our days. He, alayhi salatu wasalam, despite his busyness, would make time for this, to go to their houses, visit them, see their children and the likes. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam died, the Khalifa of the Muslims, the next leader, the busiest man on the planet now, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, in Sahih al-Bukhari, he says, he went to Umar, his right-hand man, and he said, انطلق بنا يا عمر إلى أم أيمن نزورها كما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يزورها. Come, O Umar, let's go visit Umm Ayman. Umm Ayman is an elderly woman that no politician that isn't on TV would visit. If it's not for public relations, if no one's showing it on TV of how nice you are, no one would visit. He, radiallahu anhu, who learned from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would go and visit her the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to visit her. Aisha radiallahu anha, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Bilal became very old, she used to go and visit Bilal in his house and mention to him, like she would lift his spirits, mention to him, basically, this is how much the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved you. Remember when he said this about you? Remember when he said that about you? And this is key, because certain parts of your society feel alienated, of your community will feel alienated, especially the younger half, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would wipe on their heads. And the elders. And this is just a quick talking point after the khutbah, maybe we can return to it. There used to be easiest thing in the world, it takes up a few emails and about an hour a month. We used to set up groups in New York called virtuous visitations, just like righteous visits, where a group of people would pull together one day a month to go visit the elderly in the hospitals, in their homes, and just tell them we remember you. And we make dua for you, and we enjoy your company, and we like to listen to your stories that we've heard 10 times. We like to be with you. This is extremely important, because it means that much to them. You know, in Sahih al-Bukhari, Imam al-Bukhari, he entitled an entire chapter called Ziyaratu Jibreel lil-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how Jibreel, the angel Gabriel, used to visit the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he mentioned that the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wa sallam, inquired about Jibreel, that why doesn't he visit him as much? Like, it was, I want to see you more. It's the greatest gift you can give to me, is to actually come to me. Some people think I'm not going to go visit someone because I don't have a gift, or it's too costly. The gift doesn't have to be costly. It could cost you $2-3, make some brownies at your home and carry them over, right? But even if you can't bring anything at all, what's more costly is you not visiting altogether. Even if you're empty-handed, just go. And so the Prophet ﷺ, when he was used to being visited by Jibreel, he said to Jibreel, أَلَا تَزُرُنَا أَكْثَرُ, why don't you visit us more? And so Allah the Most High sent down the verses in Surah Maryam, the chapter on Mary, the mother of Jesus. He sent down in that surah, وَمَا نَتَنَزَّلُ إِلَّا بِأَمْرِ رَبِّكَ. We are the angels, we're the servants of God, we only come down when God commands us to come. Meaning, I would love to see you more, right? But Allah is explaining to you here, it's a matter of, I can only come when He sends me. But the point being is, the Prophet ﷺ, when he stopped receiving what he was used to receiving, he felt, he was upset by this, he was saddened by this. Also, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, when he became the grand when he became the most knowledgeable man in Al-Kufa, when he left Medina after the Prophet ﷺ died, they all moved to different, many of them moved to different cities to teach people Islam. When he went to Al-Kufa, that city in Iraq, he sat with his companions, and when he sat with them, he said to them, هَلْ تَتَزَاوَرُونَ? Do you visit each other at home? Meaning, do you guys just meet in the masjid? You don't meet outside the masjid? He's telling them that's a problem. You can't do that. He said, do you visit one another at home or not? They said, yes, even if someone's at the end of Al-Kufa, we'll still go to him. قَالَ دُمْتُمْ عَلْ أَنْتُمْ عَلَى خَيْرٍ مَا دُمْتُمْ عَلَى ذَلِكَ You will remain being good people. You will be upon good. Your situation will be well off so long as you keep this up. I know sometimes it can seem like a high maintenance project to go out of your way to visit someone for the sake of God, but you need to keep doing it. You know, some people may say, I don't need to be told that visiting people is an act of worship for me to do it. In other words, I don't need religion to be a good person. Many people give this sentiment in our time, in our age. But you know, the statistics say otherwise. Research, modern research proves that people who attend mass, like communal congregations, like jama'ah, either on Sunday in church, on Friday in the masjid, people that are exposing themselves to reminders about God once a month. We do it as Muslims once a week. Christians do it, if they're consistent, once a week as well. People that do it once a month are much more likely to visit their family members than others. Because that's what it's about. Consistency, I'm not doing it for any reason. There's no business investment involved. There's no selfish interests involved. I'm doing it because this pleases God. You know, as a matter of fact, one of the reasons why visiting is high maintenance is because sometimes there's hard feelings between family members. So these people are not just able to go visit others. These people who attend religious services are not able to visit others even though they don't get benefit. They're able to visit others despite there being some sort of harm involved. They'll still do it. Even though my cousin hasn't talked to me, I'm still going to talk to them. Even though this is a bit of an annoyance for me or a complication, I'm still going to do it. Where do they get that consistency from? Because it's not for them. I'm not doing it to make money out of this. I'm not doing this for any sort of appreciation from them. And so if there's no appreciation, I'm going to stop doing it. I'm doing it for appreciation from above, from the heavens. So that's how I'll be consistent. This is the benefit of it being an act of worship. Yes, this is troublesome, but Allah the Most High has said to me, as the Prophet ﷺ reported to us, وَجَبَتْ مَحَبَّتِي لِلْمُتَحَابِّينَ فِيَّ وَالْمُتَجَالِسِينَ فِيَّ وَالْمُتَبَادِلِينَ فِيَّ وَالْمُتَزَاوِرِينَ فِيَّ دَخَلُوا فِي ثَلَاثَ مِنَ الْأَرْبَعَ The Prophet ﷺ said that Allah has said, my love has been guaranteed for those that love each other for my sake, for the sake of God, and sit with one another for my sake, and spend on each other for my sake, and visit each other for my sake. So they visit and they spend and they sit. All of that comes in visitation. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "من زار مريضا أو أخا له في الله نادى مناد من السماء طبت وطاب ممشاك وتبوأت من الجنة منزلا." When someone visits a sick person or visits their brother for the sake of Allah, it is said to him, may you be blessed, and may every step you take be a reason to be blessed, and may you secure a seat in paradise because of that visit. The angels pray for you. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in another hadith, which is Hassan, an acceptable chain of transmission, that he said to the Sahaba, هَلْ أُخْبِرُكُمْ بِرِجَالِكُمْ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ Shall I inform you which men amongst you will wind up in paradise? They said, of course, O Messenger of Allah, tell us. قَالَ النَّبِيُّ فِي الْجَنَّةِ So the prophets are in paradise. The prophet will be in paradise. وَالصِّدِّيقُ And the firmest conviction, people of firmest conviction will be in paradise. وَالشَّهِيدُ فِي الْجَنَّةِ Look at this high company. And the shaheed, the martyr, is in Jannah. وَالْمَوْلُودُ يَعْنِ الْمَوْلُودُ الَّذِي يَمُوتُ في صغره. And the newborn, meaning who dies in infancy or dies before puberty, and the newborn is in Jannah, is in paradise as well. وَالرَّجُلُ يزور أخاه في ناحية مصر لا يزوره إلا لله عز وجل في الجنة. And a man that visits his brother on the other end of town, not visiting him except for God, this person is in Jannah as well. This person is in paradise as well. You can imagine the value of this in the sight of God when such a reward is generated by it. And of course, this reward, before we end saying the importance of doing this religiously so that you can be consistent, be sure that this reward is compounded. يتضاعف when the person you're visiting or the people you're visiting are given special priority in our deen. So when you're visiting your parents, that's an obligation to visit your parents, check up on them whenever you can. If they're locals, at least once a week, some scholars say. You have to visit them, and you have to check up on them. And how many, because you know why, because how many times you ask your family on the phone, whenever you remember to call, how are you doing, and it's just cordial, regular conversation. Then when you finally show up, you say, we didn't want to bother you and make you come the whole way. You find out what's going on when you're actually there. That's why it's obligatory to visit your parents in Islam. Visiting your relatives as well is a lesser priority, but also a form of an obligation in Islam. Also, visiting people who are sick is fardu kifaya. It's a communal obligation in Islam. Passing your condolences to families of people that are bereaved, people that have died, is an obligation on Islam. Islam even obligated that when someone invites you to their wedding, the wedding of their family, you must go. Unless you have a legitimate reason to be excused, you must go. And the Prophet ﷺ said, whomever is invited to a walima, a wedding banquet, and he does not respond, he does not oblige, فَقَدْ عَصَى أَبَا الْقَاسِمِ. He has disobeyed Muhammad. He has disobeyed the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Why? Because you can imagine when someone invites you to something that means a lot to them, right? You showing up means the world to them, and you don't do it. What that does to the bonds between people. So the reward is compounded when it's an obligation. But before we compound, I want to spend the last 10 minutes in the khutbah speaking about how to not to drop below the minimum reward. Some of these rewards we mentioned. Instead of getting more reward, let's just talk about how to secure the bare minimum reward. Securing that reward is by following the etiquettes, the teachings, the classiness, how to be a classy guest when you visit somebody, which our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught his companions. After the break, bi-idhni Allah ta'ala, we'll try to list 9 for you. Remember of them what you can and apply what you can in this next holiday or winter season that's coming up, inshallah ta'ala. قُلُوا قُلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ. Alhamdulillah wahda wa salatu wa salamu ala man la nabiyya ba'da. All praise and glory be to Allah alone, and may His finest peace and blessings be upon the one after whom there is no prophet, our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So your reward is secured when you observe certain etiquettes that were taught by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I want you to reflect, even if you're not going to memorize these, just appreciate how our Islam gave us a timeless lifestyle, addresses every aspect, even the nuance, the minutiae, the tiny details of visitation. So the first of them, the Prophet ﷺ taught us that when you visit someone, you visit sparingly, like you take it easy. Yes, visiting is good and there's reward involved and it's such a great act of worship, but as the Arabs used to say, زُرْ غِبًّا تَزْدَدْ حُبًّا. Like, visit after you've been absent for a while, it'll increase the love there is for you. Meaning if you're there every single day, for many hours each day, those are two different ways to, you know, to be a burden in your visit. You visit too much, or you prolong the visit. And so, some of the Sahaba, because they just wanted to be with the Prophet ﷺ, they enjoyed his company so much, they used to come to his home at times that were not convenient, and then remain in his home before the food came, and stay in his home after the food was finished. And this is you being a burden, right? Because number one, as long as you're there, a good host, we spoke about it, has to keep serving you. That's burdensome. Also, if you come, I mean, if your kids don't know the etiquettes, then leave them somewhere else until they learn the etiquettes, right? And some people, they just bring their children to the home and the kid just, oh, look, a ball, a TV, and all this stuff, right? Islamically, you have to replace all these things when your kid breaks them. But just being a burden, sometimes a parent just sits there for hours on edge, and even if his kid is well-mannered, he's going to be well-mannered for how long? An hour? 2 hours? And then he just runs loose. And we just sit there sometimes, the women are talking to each other, the men are talking to each other, it's, oh, subhanAllah, kids are crazy. Kids are crazy, get up and do something, right? And so some of the Sahaba, though well-intending, they were oblivious to what's happening around them. Even if it wasn't children, there was still some sort of burden. And so Allah Azza wa Jalla used to say, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تدخلوا بيوت النبي إلا يؤذن لكم إلى طعام غير ناظرين إناه ولكن إذا دعيتم فدخلوا فإذا طعمتم فانتشروا ولا مستأنسين لحديث. He says, when you enter the Prophet's home, you don't enter the home waiting for the food to be prepared. You're waiting until they cook. You come real early. But when you're invited in, then come in, and then once you eat, don't just sit there enjoying the conversation. He says, why? He says, إِنَّ ذَٰلِكُمْ كَانَ يُؤْذِي النَّبِيَّ فَيَسْتَحِي مِنْكُمْ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَسْتَحِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ. This bothers the Prophet, عليه الصلاة والسلام. But he was too shy to mention it to you, and Allah is not too shy to mention to you right from wrong. Allah's going to point it out. He's not going to let this slide. And likewise, people can just get exhausted from people. Ash-Sha'bi, rahimahullah, one of the great scholars, used to say, إِذَا فَاتَتْكَ رَكْعَتَيْن أَوْ رَكْعَتَا الْفَجْرِ فَلْعَنِ الثُّقَلَى. When you miss the two rak'ahs of fajr, curse, he means make dua against, blame the people that are just ثُقَلَى. They're just heavy, right? They're overbearing. They come and it's 9, 10, 11, 12, and it's not the fajr at 3 a.m. sometimes. Right? Blame them. It's all their fault. This is the first thing. When you visit graciously, sparingly. And when you arrive, that's a second one. Then Islam taught us that when you arrive and be light in your arrival. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا دَخَلْتُمْ بُيُوتًا غَيْرَ بُيُوتِكُمْ لَدْخُلُوا بُيُوتًا غَيْرَ بُيُوتِكُمْ حَتَّى تَسْتَأْنِسُوا وَتُسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. When you enter, O believers, when you enter, can you imagine Allah actually addresses this in the Quran? Is that important? When you enter homes that are not your homes, don't do so until you seek permission first. نسو يعني استأذنوا. Until you seek permission first, and then go in, and then, after permission is granted, and then make sure you greet. You say, Assalamu alaikum, announce your entrance after permission has been given. The Prophet ﷺ said, الاستئذان ثلاثة. You seek permission 3 times. Like one knock means I'm here. I'm here. The second, that means I'm gonna leave. Right? The third, it means I'm gone. I'm leaving now. And you're supposed to leave. Because maybe he invited you, maybe you had permission. By the time you arrive at the door, him and his wife got into World War III. Or some kid got hurt. Or he just caught some diarrhea. Or any sort of emergency. Isn't it possible? Don't feel like you have to be received even though you were invited. Things change. The Sahaba said, the Prophet ﷺ, his door used to be knocked on with the fingertips. And this is just amazing. Look how classy the Sahaba radiallahu anhu in the middle of a desert 1400 years ago became. Like, how do you transform an entire generation to be this etiquette oriented? If this is not a miracle, what is a miracle? The Prophet ﷺ transformed this generation. You know, knocking with their fingertips out of respect means, imagine people that bang the door, or they allow their kids to just ring the bell over and over and over and over again. And Imam Ahmad, once a guy came and pounded on his door, and he came out and saw that he knew the person. قَالَ لَهُ أَضَرْبِ الشُّرَطَى. Like, is this a raid? It's a police raid. Like, are you the cops? Like, why are you banging for? Unless you know there's a fire in the house, or he told you keep banging until I wake up for fajr or something, right? As if we live close enough to each other. But why? They used to knock with their fingertips, despite in the beginning of Islam, when the Quran was still being revealed early Medina, Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَادُونَكَ مِنْ وَرَاءِ الْحُجُرَاتِ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. These people who call out to you from behind the walls are not sensible people. So if you have a people who their culture is, Muhammad, come out! That was their culture. To move all the way on the other end of the spectrum and start doing this, that degree of politeness, consideration, that's what the Prophet ﷺ brought to the world, developed that. So the second one is when you arrive, you arrive also graciously. And then you sit, the Prophet ﷺ taught us to sit where you are told. And you don't separate between two people. So there's two people on the couch. You don't sit in the middle. Even that degree, a Muslim is above, right? He doesn't separate between any two people. Nor does he keep it, make the place tight. إذا قيل لكم تفسحوا في المجالس فافسحوا يفسح الله لكم. When you're told make space in the gathering, make space, Allah will make space for you in your life. He'll make your life comfortable. As opposed to someone who walks in and there's no seat and you're just on your phone or you're just busy in your conversation and you have one knee up on the couch and you're taking the whole love seat, right? Make room for people. Be considerate of that. And also part of sit where you are told, it's because al-buyut awra. Inna buyutana, buyut are vulnerable, right? You can enter, someone tells you, please, sit here. Say, no, here's fine. But what if he doesn't want you sitting there? What if you're going to see something in his house, right? It's a bad angle. Where the poor woman who's been standing on 200 degree heat for the past 4 hours is going to have to put on her hijab now because of you. Or you may see something of her, right? Which is unacceptable. And so when you enter, you sit where you are told and you don't separate between people. And then when you enter, this is a little bit difficult for us to apply with our children, when we visit our children. Follow instructions no matter who you are. The Prophet ﷺ said, nobody is to be led in prayer in his house, fi sultani, in his domain, except with his permission. So if he's the one that is to lead you in religion, in deen, in prayer, then he can definitely lead the gathering, right? And so when grandparents come over and the parents set certain rules for the kids and you just destroy all of that, not even your own children, just let them be in their domain. Let them run the show. The fifth, and I only have about 2 minutes left, so I'll run through some of them quickly. Make sure to be inclusive in your discussions. Our Prophet ﷺ used to say, لا يتناجى اثنان دون الثالث من أجل أن ذلك يحزنه فإن ذلك يحزنه. He says, let no two people have a conversation and leave out the third person. So they're whispering to each other, or they're speaking in a language the third person can't understand, because this saddens him, saddens that third person. And of course, we can extend this to two people sitting together, and you pull out a third on your screen, right? You're just having a conversation with someone, and ignoring the guy who just spent to feed you, and took out from his time, or took a day off from work, or did all of this stuff. This is unacceptable Islamically. That's not how a visitor acts in Islam. Also, a part of this is to maintain the privacy of the conversation, right? You don't walk out of the house and tell people what was took place in the house with the conversation. You don't walk out and say, oh, this person, what I saw. And then you sometimes people pick at people's privacy. Like you enter the home and say, oh man, that clock, this TV, how much did you get that for? Are you like an estimator? Like, are you a seller? Like, what are you asking for? What do you care? Don't probe into people's privacy, and whatever they give you willingly, don't share it with others. And there are so many examples of how the Prophet ﷺ, when he visited people, he was alert to their sensitivities. He never, ever, ever criticized any food. Imagine when we visit people for their weddings, the next day everybody's talking about how bad the food was, right? Everyone's criticizing the food. And that's why we said last week, don't force someone to eat, so you'll force them to give you the reason why they're not eating. Maybe they don't like it. The Prophet ﷺ, even when when he was sitting with people in a gathering, one of them passed gas. And so the people began to laugh. And so he stopped the gathering. He said, أَيَضْحَكُ أَحَدُكُمْ مِمَّا يَصْنَعُ. Does one of you laugh at something that they themselves do? Like, who doesn't pass gas? Maybe this guy has a medical condition. Maybe he has a gas problem. Do not allow that to be sensitive to people in these gatherings. And of course, of the greatest sensitivities you need to have is regarding the elders as well. When two of them came to argue in front of the Prophet ﷺ, he said, he stopped one of them, he said, kebbir, kebbir. Respect the elder, respect no matter who you are, what station you, how tall you get in life, you respect your elders. And the eighth, and finally I'll close with it is absolutely important for us to remember that if this is an act of worship, if this is done for the sake of Allah, then it must uphold the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're going to attend the wedding and there's violations happening, you don't participate. If it's going to be a huge disaster for you to leave, then step out, give your regards, and step out. If you absolutely must attend, or else there's going to be like a family meltdown. If you're sitting in a gathering and someone pulls out shisha, and there's no scholar in his right mind who believes that this pipe, right? The water pipe. is halal. You stop them. Someone's speaking about something haram. People are delaying the prayer beyond its time. If they cannot, know your place. Know your place. Do not flip the table on anyone. Get up and pray on your own. Right? Do not participate yourself. Know your place though when you're observing Allah's rules. You know, I read one hadith preparing for this khutbah, and with it I will close, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Juhayfa says, and this hadith is controversial regarding its authenticity, but just imagine yourself in the Prophet's shoes, right? He was visited by someone, and that someone was doing something inappropriate. This happens both ways is fine, whether you're the host or you're the guest. And this person, when they came, they had eaten so much that when they arrived, they ate before they came. He burped out loud. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Kuffa anna jusha'aka." Keep your burps from here, from our gatherings. فَإِنَّ أَكْثَرُكُمْ شَبَعًا فِي الدُّنْيَا أَطْوَلُهُمْ جُوعًا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The one who fills his stomach the most in this world will have the longest hunger on the Day of Judgment. The narrator says, Aun says, Abu Juhayfa never ate his fill until he left this world. Like, he never filled his stomach again. What's the point here? What if it was you? What if you said this to your host or said this to your guest? Would the story end with, he never made that mistake again? That's not your place. You're not that person. You need to understand who it would be a much more ugly ending, right? And so find words that are gentler, or don't address it at all. And ninth and finally, you make dua for everyone you sit with. When you come to someone's house, you make dua for them before you eat. Allahumma at'im man at'amani, wasqi man saqani. And all these du'as the Prophet ﷺ would make them in English, make them in Arabic, it doesn't matter. Show people your gratitude, show people your gratefulness for the invite. This is the Muslim guest, the Muslim visitor. May Allah Azza wa Jalla improve our manners and yours, and help us implement at least some of this in the upcoming vacation times and visitations that will be exchanged. Allahumma ameen. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات، أعز الإسلام وانصر المسلمين، اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين، عاف مبتلانا ومبتلى المسلمين. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا البشير النذير محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.